So we have a patient with ovarian cyst. I have put in the 10 mm telescope. She is a case of primary infertility. Taking a look around, we see the liver side is clear. Stomach is well deflated. I have put three ports, two on my side and one on the assistant side. So three ports have been placed. So when I put the scope inside, there is presence of fluid in the peritoneal cavity. So this is likely to be because of the ovulation effect, perhaps because the ovary is showing some signs of ovulation over here. So mid-cycle, you might find free fluid in the pelvic area. So the ovary is having a normal cyst plus corpus luteum. And this is a size, this is a place where we are supposed to be having the dermoid, but the ovary does not seem to be too large. So we might have to open the ovary, hunt for the presence of a dermoid. Sometimes smaller the size of the cyst, more difficult it is to remove it. Fluid seems to be clear. So if you need to collect it, you can collect the fluid for cytology. Uterus appears to be quite normal. Uterus is quite normal and fine. This is a right side ovary, which is supposed to be having the dermoid as diagnosed by ultrasound. We need to open the ovary and evaluate. The left side ovary is also bulky. I would have perhaps labeled it as polycystic if the sign of ovulation was not so evidently seen. Tube appears to be normal on both the side. Section off. So first we will deal with the ovary and then we will assess the tube from the infertility perspective. Now, whenever you have to operate on the ovary, the main concern is whether you are going to cause damage to the follicular reserve. So because you do not want to damage the follicular reserve, use vasopressin in the broad ligament. Vasopressin. So we take 20 units of vasopressin in 200 ml of normal saline. Dilution factor is always 10 units in 100 ml. So 20 units of vasopressin is put in 200 ml of normal saline. And that is what we are going to inject into the infundibulopelvic area. I need to operate and open the ovarian tissue. I cannot miss on the dermoid. So the tissue trauma is going to be there. Lift the ovary. You can see the infundibulopelvic here. Now there are vessels in this area. Very easily you can allow the bevel to enter just inside the peritoneum. See, this is just below the peritoneum. Rotate so that the bevel is towards the broad ligament and inject. So this is the vasopressin which we are injecting into the infundibulopelvic. Thoda relax kar. I need to be careful to make sure that I don't puncture the vessels over here. About 15 ml is what will get injected on the higher side. So don't try to inject too much. More than half of it has gotten spilled back, which is fine. But whatever 10-15 ml gets injected, suction on kara, is sufficient. Whatever spill I am trying to suction out, because that contains vasopressin, so rather than allowing it to have peritoneal absorption into the circulation, I would prefer to remove it. Support. Tooth nail holder, scissor. don't grasp it. Here, sir. A larger cyst I always would prefer because it will be easy to identify and know where to cut. This is the most confusing situation as to where exactly do I need to cut. Dissector, yeah. But there is no option. I need to open the ovary and try to figure out if we can identify or find some sort of a cyst. The surface is also looking a little unusual. If she would have had a previous surgery done, I would have felt that this is the effect of the glove powder. But here I am not too certain. So the vasopressin has been injected into the broad ligament. Don't inject the vasopressin into the ovarian tissue. This is not like the myometrium which we use for myomectomy. The ovarian tissue will not cooperate with the saline. So trying to split it open and hoping that we get some sort of a resemblance of a cyst. Tooth grasper aankhi nahi ka? There. Oozing indicates that I am in the ovarian tissue. So this is ovarian tissue. Still onto the ovarian tissue. Now this apparently is where the cystic plane might come unless it turns out to be a follicular cyst. So that's a follicular cyst. And below the follicular cyst here we are getting a cyst. So this, now what I am getting is the dermoid cyst. I need to avoid using the cautery as much as possible. So we will worry about the oozing and the bleeding part after we have separated the cyst completely. It's a bilobed cyst. Grasp per the. Huh, this is a dermoid. Yellowishness is typical for a dermoid. So it looks like a dermoid for now. Let us see there. So now if you took a little panoramic view, you can see the yellowishness is typical compared to the pink tissue here. So I am avoiding holding the dermoid and pulling. See, I'm using the cyst wall or the ovarian tissue as a preference. Because I'm trying to avoid poking. It's too small. Even if I do end up poking or opening up the dermoid, this spillage is going to be a little convenient to wash out. But as far as possible, have the patience. To peel off gently. Come on, come on, come on. slightly uneven is giving me a bigger challenge. I am ignoring the bleeding for now because does not make much sense to try and cauterize. Once the cyst has come out, there is some amount of retraction of the ovarian wall also which happens. And oozing then can be pinpoint identified and taken care of. Need to be a little more gentler on the side of the cyst. Previous corpus luteum fat is creating confusion. So this part, whether it is another extension of a dermoid kind of a cyst or suction radii. Is it a corpus luteum or another dermoid? Not getting a grip. So there is one, two, and the third one here. Not a good option to open too much of the ovary, but right now I don't have a better solution. I'm going to use Rapid to close the ovary. Slightly confusing picture still. Okay, let's try and separate this cyst first and then see if there is another one below it. Too much of yellowness. Scissor. I'm going to try and peel off the cover on this side. Okay, this looks like multiple follicles. The ovary is trying to play some tricks. Let me evaluate the bleeding. Suction, Graspadara. It's not too much of a bleeding which is happening, but sometimes ovaries are notorious for the moment it is in control. There. Come on, I need to now say please and request that the cyst cooperates and comes out. Normally speaking, the dermoids have a nice capsular cover. Here the fat appears to be causing some confusion. So the upper two cysts are now sort of making way. So is this another dermoid or is this just a corpus luteum cyst? Because that is the fat which was creating so much of confusion. This is that lower third cyst. Aja, aja. Okay, it's still not sure. This is it. This is the glove cutting exercise which you do where you have to cut only a millimeter. Looks like a dermoid, very small one. Suction. But definitely no hair or any other tissues, it's just a sebaceous material or fat. Not even sebaceous actually, it's just fat. Histopathology itself will identify whether this part was also a dermoid or it was just a another one over here. The dilemma is how much to separate, reducing the risk of recurrence and reducing the risk of follicular trauma. Just one small part now remaining. I think I'll peel it off and then we will evaluate whether I need to trim this part of the ovary. Yeah, so the base part, this part where we have the fat being seen, we will evaluate whether we need to trim this part out of the entire ovary or leave it inside. Endobag open kara. So this fortunately has come out intact. Suction. Now, if you evaluate, you can see that the oozing has stopped or reduced significantly. Now, wherever there is a pinpoint oozer, I don't mind touching with a bipolar. But before we touch with the bipolar, let us evaluate. So this is the base which is oozing, which I will coagulate. This is the bulk of the ovary, which I initially cut over here, which bled. So this is the ovarian tissue, normal healthy ovarian tissue. So this is not apparently having any cyst. The lower pole, this area, is still having, I think we better to cut off this strip. I don't want to have a recurrence. Because multiple small cysts are there, and what we removed in the end did open up like a dermoid. Come closer. Looks like a dermoid. Suction. Fat content. Scissor. Uchal. Not very happy about cutting off this part of the ovary, but I think it is a little better. Support. This should be the last part because I'm still intent on saving as much of the ovary as possible. Three parts. Not very happy with the outcome as such. The bleeding, whatever is happening, like I mentioned, I can always use a pinpoint coagulation and cauterize it. seems to be still some more fat there. So normally, if it is a single location, I would leave it, considering that it is a corpus luteal cyst with fat, and ignore it and come out. But multiple such collections inside the ovary are not becoming comfortable enough for me to leave it dissected. So if I carefully now try to evaluate the upper wall, looks like I've removed everything. One small part is now left over here. Apart from that, everything is removed, clear. Bipolar. I'm hoping that I don't end up overcoagulating. So there are a few surface coagulation points. The vasopressin does not seem to have had the desired effect in this case, probably because of the situation, the location, the vascularity is also equally more. Section. Now the bleeding is less. Don't randomly coagulate on the entire opened out surface of the ovary. Select the point where you feel the maximum oozes and touch only those points. So now you see that the oozing has been effectively controlled. It's not significant now. Now we should be able to remove the content. So nahi, wo already normal jaisa hi hai. We would rather, this is just a normal cyst. There is no fatty content in it. And ovulation is there, so puncturing will not aid. Another concern which I usually have is because I have already operated so much on the right ovary, it does impact the follicle reserve to a certain extent. So I would rather not touch the left ovary support. So there are five small pieces over here which I need to remove. I am going to use the TUR set bag as an endo bag. I'm going to extend the upper port, not for the morcellator, but just to be able to put the bag inside and take the tissue out from that port. So 10 mm stretching. So there has been a query from a viewer that what happens if it ruptures when dissection. If it ruptures during dissection, the only thing I would do is remove the head low So I would allow that sebaceous or the fatty content to collect into the pouch area and then remove it with suction irrigation from the pouch. Later on, continue with the dissection. So this is just a TUR set bag. Hot betadine swab. It's a sterile polythene bag which becomes an endo bag. There. So one of the simplest way to use this endo bag is push it below the uterus. Into the pouch. So because it has gone into the pouch, you have the mouth which is open in front of you. Support. There. Yes. So this is one. Yeah, there are five pieces. Two. Three. Four. Supposed to be one more. Suction. The problem is if it gets sucked into the suction, I would not come to know. So let's. Can't see anything more. So I'm holding the mouth there. Mouth is held up. There is a possibility that it was small enough, or it may get washed out and suctioned out later directly. So I'm not going to be too overly worried about it. There. So I'm going to remove the mouth of the bag from the 10 mm port over here. So the mouth of the bag has now come outside. So the complete circumferential mouth is out. ovum forceps. So I need to now puncture this without puncturing the bag. The ovum forceps has gone in. So you hold some tissue, don't hold the bag. You have to make sure that you are not holding the bag and only the tissue is pulled out. So because it is under vision, you can make sure that you are holding only the tissue. So two are outside. Three. Now what is remaining is a bigger one. I need to now crush this in the ovum forceps. So now I am able to grab it. That is hair. So because it is already crushed, now don't pull the mouth of the bag out. Never pull the mouth out. Bag, if you are pulling, you are going to end up exerting a lot of force on the polythene and then the bag might rupture. Now already the cyst is ruptured. So allow gently to go inside. Because already the cyst is ruptured, the tissue will come out. It takes time for this hair and the other tissue to come out. But have the patience not to pull on the bag. And then because we have already opened it, suction. It takes time for the suction also to be effective. Let it take time. Yeah, we can put 10 mm also if I want, but right now this is adequate because what is going to happen is the tissue will now get gripped in the ovum forceps. And the tissue has now come out. Once more suction, don't be in a hurry to pull the bag out. Otherwise at the last minute that ruptures. Now, maximum fluid has also come out. With the suction inside the bag, I am pulling the bag out. Now, immediately suction fluid. Immediately suction the fluid out. So, this is getting the suction washed. Otherwise, rarely what has happened is I have kept this aside and then when I give a wash, that sebaceous material has gone in the peritoneal cavity. So everything including hair has come out in the endo bag. Rapid, yeah, Michael. Kima rapid, Michael ge unge. So 20 Vicryl is what we are going to use to close the ovary. Now let us check. So dusra hoga to 30 le lo. Nahi 30 hoga to dekh lo. Round body. Here I would prefer round body. So there is no bleeding. See, if you now see this, whatever 5-10 ml of blood is seen, this is okay. This is not a hemorrhagic bleed. That means I don't have to touch the cautery now on the ovary again. Wash. There. Meko port closure bhi karna padega. To tap it de do. So I've not been able to see that fifth small part, but I guess whatever section we are doing, it is adequate to remove that also. So I've taken 20 Vicryl Rapid. The idea is to have a closure of the ovary so that adhesion formation is prevented. It is not for hemostasis. क्लीन करायला द्या. बरं, बेंड केले मागे नको. Ovary is quite bulky as such, so fortunately I feel that whatever trauma or fibrosis or tissue damage has happened, ovary is still sufficient for having enough reserve. So this is almost like a so-called purse string closure. The idea being just to approximate the raw edges. Not for hemostasis. Again, I am repeating, this is not for hemostasis. This is so that the opened out ovary is not going to lay on the bowel and cause significant adhesions. Every bite which I take has a potential to cause more bleeding. So I have to be a little more prudent in trying to figure out how much of bites have to be taken. Zero Rapid has an advantage that because this is least reactive thread, there will be no suture reaction and fibrosis in the ovary because of this. Do not strangulate the tissues. The intention is basically to get the raw area to come together. Sort of purse string. There is no clear-cut defined way in which I am suturing. I am just bringing the edges together. But keep in mind that you don't want to unnecessarily strangulate too much of tissue. So this particularly today has not been a surgeon-friendly case. Like the fibroid when I did in the morning, I told you it was surgeon-friendly. A simple 4-5 centimeter, 8 centimeter dermoid easily allows you to get into the correct plane. Dermoids usually are thick-walled. Chances of avulsion is also not very high. And you are able to finish the surgery easily like a fibroid. But when the size of the dermoid is small or there are multiple small ones like today, the dilemma is much more between creating unnecessary trauma to the ovary and removing clearly enough so that you do not have recurrence. Head high kara, glove kara, catheter taka. So now the ovary looks comfortable. When you do a scan after 3 months, it will show a normal size or a bulky ovary here. Head eye. So give a steep head high. Kar steep hai je. Kar bas. Fluid is clear on the upper side, similar to the ovary. You can see those spots over there. So allow the fluid to run down into the pelvis. There. Easier to suction the fluid from the pelvic area. Sir, now we'll make a head low again. Kara. Kara. Bas. There. So whatever has been in the paracolic area comes down into the pelvic area, gets washed out a little more easily. There. No active oozing as such. There is some collection happening which is bound to be there, but it is not dripping down. Huh. Since she is an infant, grasp her out. Since there is so much of fat in the mesosalpinx also. This is because of the vasopressin injection that the fat is seen floating freely. This is not the actual area. But she is so thin, but still the fat is there. Anyway, so before we close, we are going to do a dye test, methylene blue. Since she is infertility. That is just to complete the evaluation. So this is injectable methylene blue, IV methylene blue, not normal lab quality. What is it? Or this. Fortunately, I have not had to use too much of cautery, because when I started cutting in the beginning, there was a worry which I had that I couldn't identify where exactly is the cervix is pinpoint as is expected. Not able to see it yet. So now I have the cervix. Important for the dye also to come out, because otherwise we'll end up doing the cannulation for her. Just checking to see that the os is open. So dye coming in from one side. Tube chazavadiya. Zavadiya. Come closer. Yeah, there is. Isme methrin do daliye nor. I'll do it. Chashmala. So final assessment. On this side, we have the dye coming in. Yes. So we have free spill of dye from both the sides. So that's the end of the procedure. One final wash to remove the methylene blue. And we'll put saline 1 liter into the peritoneal cavity, plus port closure is required. And there is no bleeding now. You can see that there is no blood which is collecting. I'm avoiding handling the ovary right now. But since nothing is trickling down, that means we have been able to have good, adequate hemostasis. And since cautery is not required, better not to disturb, because there will be some clot effect which would have come, and I am not very keen on disturbing that clotting effect. So 1 liter saline, and in that saline we are going to put ropivacaine 10 cc.
So for putting dialysis,
Yes, yes, yes. Either you can, there are different types of Robin's cannula or Colvin's cannula. Whichever is comfortable, anything can be used. Even sometimes if you are doing hysteroscopy, then the inflow of the hysteroscopy, you can remove the inflow, attach a syringe and push the dye. So all in all, though it was not a very surgeon-friendly situation, for the dermoid, the outcome has been pretty good. Because from my side, I'm quite sure that I have been able to remove most of it. This is ropivacaine going inside, getting diluted in that 1 liter of saline. Ropivacaine into the port sites. So thank you very much for watching the procedure with us today. And with this, we will end the broadcast.